can't follow Jesus and be better than that. Church, before I start, I want to ask you if I can just speak to you about my drama for this past week. I had some drama this past week, and I guess some of us did. From last Saturday to Wednesday night, I had drama because I brought 2 Powerball tickets. And I kept saying, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You know how you make a list, a wish list, and I'm putting all these things down that I'm going to do. Stayed up late Wednesday night to listen to the Powerball. And all I prayed for was the Powerball. So I'm letting the numbers come out. They none of them match mine. So I said, oh. Then I looked at the second ticket, and guess what I had? The Powerball. And it was a winning ticket, but I only won $4. So that was my drama for the week. I don't know if anybody else can relate to that. But I want to break open the word today. And I'm going to preach, if I can, with the help of God. And my theme is, a change is going to come, church. A change is going to come. A number of years ago, I was talking with my grandpa, who was born in 1911. And he stated, not in my lifetime. My mother, who was born 26 years later, agreed, not in my lifetime. 21 years later, I was born, and I agreed, it wouldn't be in my lifetime. And our daughter, born 31 years later, nodded, not in my lifetime. I'm sure many of you may have said the same. However, the winds of change have been blowing for a time, not strong but steady. And it blows today, those winds of peace. And these winds awaken us today to hear the word of God and the people he chose to deliver his messages. Today we honor one of his chosen ones, Dr. Martin Luther King, on the 40th anniversary of his death. A man of God who would not, could not be quiet until his people were free. The change that Jesus makes today in the gospel, his first miracle, and the change that Dr. King spoke of will come swiftly. We are reminded by God when he spoke to the prophet Habakkuk, which was one of Dr. King's favorite scriptures. The prophet called out to God, Lord, how long must I call for help before you listen? Before you save us from violence? Why do you make me see such trouble? How can you stand to look on such wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are all around me, and there's fighting and quarreling everywhere. The law is weak and useless, and justice is never done. The Lord gave him his answer. Write it down clearly. Put it in writing, because it is not time for it to come true. But the time is coming quickly, and what I will show you will come true. It may seem slow in coming, but wait for it. It will certainly take place and will not be delayed. This is the message. Those who are evil will not survive, but those who are righteous will live because they are faithful to God. Through the years, there have been many prophets, saints, and inspired people who stood up and refused to be quiet and could not be turned around by the lures of the world. They were the ones who continued to bring the good news to all God's people. They are the ones who keep the winds of change moving and urging all of us to build the beautiful, peaceful world as we have been asked by God. The Gospel of John is quite appropriate to parallel some of the actions of Dr. King with his responding to the calling of Jesus. The Gospel of John is a book of signs. Each sign, each epiphany emanates from Jesus. None comes from nowhere else. John says, he is the light of the world, and in him was light. Today we find Jesus, his mother, and disciples are invited to a wedding where Jesus changed water into wine. John's signs are set in the course of ordinary human events, ordinary events that everyone knows. John asked us to see the Word become flesh in the midst of us in the course of human events. Jesus came to make things new, starting with his birth, where he humbled himself to share in our humanity. His baptism, where he made it new, as John the Baptist stated, "I am only baptizing with water. There's someone coming greater than me who will be baptizing with fire." Jesus made baptism new with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the forgiveness of sins, and with a new family, as we witness today with our new family member. During the course of the wedding, the wine runs out. Mary says, "They have no wine." If we judge Jesus' response, it was an irritating challenge. One would believe that he may have been annoyed. However, Mary is holding him responsible. Why? One reason, consistent with the other signs in John's gospel and in the keeping of John's exact words, could be Mary could not stand by and watch an injustice. She was not to watch the groom and his bride be disgraced. She did not want their marriage celebration to have lasting shame as its memory. And in response to her compassion for them, Jesus does what Mary, in a famous song in Luke's gospel, proclaims. He fills the hungry with good things. Jesus replenished the wine, a new wine, which he makes new for us to share at communion. Rosa Parks, based on her need and being tired, sat down to stand up against the humiliation, the inhuman treatment she had been subjected to on a daily basis. I would like to imagine that the interchange between Mary and Jesus resembles the interchange between Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King, if they were to have an interchange. One of the many injustices confronted about African Americans in Montgomery, Alabama, and many states in the South, and as Malcolm X stated, that all states below the Canadian border were Southern states. Ms. Parks, by refusing to give up her seat on the bus, or give in to one more instance of humiliation of her and her people, Parks provoked a moment in history and provoked King entry into that moment as his vital wine and transforming agent. In their joint action, his ministry to the nation and the world was open. It was declared that the moment was at hand. He was not at first sure that he was in fact the right moment, but somewhat reluctantly, he responded to her situation. I would imagine during the quiet times of prayer, Dr. King may have asked, "Why me? Why me, God? I'm just an ordinary man. I just wanted to lead a church, not a movement." Dr. King responded to that request, and that response became the first of King's unforgettable signs, moments of light in a ministry in which he lived, as John's gospel said, Jesus did, offering a powerful sign in human situations. Jesus' signs grow more stunning in John's gospel, and so will King's. For both men, the red thread connecting all their moments in compassionate justice, which reached out to raise people from many kinds of death and shame. While Dr. Martin Luther King did not change water into wine, he did change words into a new wine of commitment. He did gather thousands to hear him, and they were fed. He did raise those whose lives were decaying in death. He did proclaim speaking truth to power to the educated Nicodemuses of America that they needed to be born again in mind and spirit. He did raise the injustice of the dead daughters of Birmingham, speaking of them in an unforgettable letter to the white clergies from the tomb of his jail cell in that city. He did lift up as to us a cup of everlasting life, and we drink from it today and always. John's gospel insisted on radical equality, all of us incarnating the Word, even as we drink the good wine of communion. The Book of Common Prayers bids us each night in our lives to pray that God's Spirit will shield the joyous, which is what Mary and Joseph did at Cana. The prayer declares that Jesus and his mother knew that the joyous were are essential to the justice of the world. And today I must confess that my grandpa, my mother, my daughter, myself, and many of us were not totally wrong. For today we stand on the cusp of a new world order, a time of forgiving during this year of mercy declared by Pope Francis. The winds of change continue to blow, as Sam Cooke reminds us that a change is going to come. It took a long time coming, but a change is going to come. It may not be when we want it to, but it will happen in God's time. We have to stay focused on the Word of God, and just as important, stay focused on living the Word of God each and every day, and continue to work the world new, individually and collectively, each day. During these difficult times, when the world seems to be going crazy, we must remember that step by step, we need to depend on the Word of God and pray for the coming of the Lord with truth and justice. Like the song says, it's already done. We're just waiting for our change to come. We ought to be at peace. However, peace is not the same as being docile. We need to be assertive, firm, even passionate and bold, yet be at peace. Peace is deeper than the quiet interaction. Peace requires participation, church. I would be remiss if I didn't mention April 2015. I just want to say that all lives matter, from womb to tomb, just not black lives. But did you know that there was 1,000 shootings in 2015 in Baltimore City? Of those, 344 were homicides. And of that, 300 were African-American males from the age of 16 to 62. Where is our action? Where is our protests? Where is our marching? There also was many people wounded, and there's many people that are suffering from the aftershocks of that. We have many children with PTSD. We have many adults with PTSD. And we still have no protests. And this is not indigenous only to Baltimore, but they are indigenous to all the cities in this country. All over the nation, black males are becoming an endangered species. What are we going to do about that, church? Let us pray that we can stop committing our own genocides and let the young men grow to reach their potential. However I feel about that, I'm hopeful that the change will come. I recently found a book which had the last Christmas sermon of Dr. King in 1967. And I would like to, because it gave me hope. It gave me another reason to keep on going. And I want to share the ending of that sermon with you. In 1963, on a sweltering August afternoon, we stood in Washington, D.C., and talked to the nation about many things. Towards the end of that afternoon, I tried to talk about I had a dream. And I confess to you today, and not long after talking about that dream, I started seeing it turn into a nightmare. Just a few weeks after I talked about it, there were four beautiful, unoffending, innocent Negro girls were murdered in a church in Birmingham, Alabama. I watched that dream turn into a nightmare as I moved through the ghettos of the nation and saw my black brothers and sisters perishing on a lonely island of poverty and the vast ocean of material prosperity, and saw the nation doing nothing to grapple with the Negro problem of poverty. I saw that dream turn into a nightmare as I watched my black brothers and sisters, in the midst of their anger an unstandable rage and disappointment, turn to misguided riots to try to solve that problem. Yes, I am personally the victim of deferred dreams, of plastic hopes, but in spite of that, I close by today saying, I still have a dream, because you cannot give up on life. If you lose hope, somehow you lose that vitality that keeps life moving. You lose that courage to be, that quality that helps you to go on in spite of all. And today, I still have a dream. I still have a dream that one day, men and women will rise up and come to say that we are made to live together as brothers and sisters. I still have a dream this morning that every Negro in this country, every colored person in this country and in this world will be judged on the basis of the content of their character rather than the color of their skin. Every man and woman will respect the dignity and worth of human personality. I still have a dream that in all the state houses and city halls, men and women will be elected to go there who will justly love mercy and walk humbly with their God. I still have a dream today war will come to an end and that men will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks, and nations will not rise up against nations, rather they will study war no more. I still have a dream that one day the lamb and the lion will lie together, and every man and woman will sit under their own fig tree, and none shall be afraid. I still have a dream that every valley shall be exalted, every mountain and hill will be made low, and rough places will be made smooth, and crooked roads straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. I still have a dream that with this faith, we be able to adjourn the council of despair and bring the light into the darkened chambers of pessimism. With this faith, we will be able to speed up that day when there will be peace on earth and goodwill towards men and women. It will be a glorious day. The morning stars will sing together, and the sons and daughters of God will shout for joy. So, my friend, the dreamer has left us, but the dream continues. And it's up to all of us to make it a reality. Can you hear and feel the winds of change? As Sam Cooke said, a change is going to come. We have to wait on it. And they still bring in peace to all.
In a little tent, oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.